Okay, here is the wrap-up on the Bradford.
There were no side position markers in this, so I installed them up to the 12th fret. So what we have here is the original bridge, solid aluminum, and it's sculpted for the intonation. But because of the vintage of this guitar, this is kind of late 50s, early 60s. At that time, you have to understand that the third string was always wound. It wasn't until Clapton and Hendrix came along and started using banjo strings that we ended up with a plain third. And Jonathan uses a plain third, 10 to 46 strings, concert pitch. So with this bridge, you would never be able to intonate it. I did have a couple of tunematic bridges, Les Paul style tunematic bridges, but the profile was too high. We wouldn't be able to get the strings close enough to the fingerboard for this thing to be playable and for it to intonate. So I just made a bridge and intonated it, and you'll hear it's perfectly in tune. Okay, so next thing, this is just a template to locate the bridge so it butts up against the chrome pickup ring, and that puts the bridge where it needs to be. It is a floating bridge. When you change strings, if you knock it with your hand, it will move around. So this way the customer can always sort of triple check to get the right location. So we'll just leave that in the case for Jonathan. Well, like the early Gretsch guitars, this has a zero fret, and the nut, what would normally be the nut now, is really just a string guide. I replaced that original nut because the string spacing was like out to lunch. So I made that new nut, which is actually, like I said, just a string guide, and we have that zero fret, and then that's it. I did spray the switches a little bit. They were a little scratchy. And this guitar is done. Let's go have a listen. So this is just the neck pickup. Neck pickup. We did what could be done without pulling the frets, completely correcting the fingerboard and doing a complete refret on this non-adjustable neck. So these are just on-off switches. This is the bridge. This would be the neck. And in a nutshell, that's what we got. A very playable guitar and quite a nice sound, actually. Since we're doing these two instruments for Jonathan, this archtop guitar you just saw, and this jazz bass, we're going to address all of the issues that we faced. There were quite a few more than expected with this jazz bass, so let me walk you through it. So most bass players can understand that the jazz bass with the narrower neck is very flexible. And this presented an issue with this, because what was happening was there was too much relief in the neck, and then you had that big swoop at the end of the neck where that square portion is received into the body. In order to adjust the truss rod on this very flexible neck, loosen the strings off completely, and then tighten the truss rod and force the neck actually into a bit of a back bow. And then we relied on the strings to pull the neck back up straight. An added issue with this particular bass is we kind of ran out of threads on the truss rod. It was maxed out, even with the strings off, and we needed more tension on it, but we couldn't get more tension. I have shown this before in previous videos, but I'm going to show you again because it was pretty unique what we needed to do to get the load just so. This bass is done. It is silky smooth to play, and we got the neck exactly where it needs to be. These are Rotosound strings 45 to 105. I started with this Hex 1032 Union, held it in my little mini vise, and cut it in half. So that was the first step. So in order to cut that in half, I kind of held it in my vise, cut it in half. So for the next step, I through-drilled those threads to open them up so that the inside diameter was big enough to accept the threads on the truss rod of the bass. So we're going somewhere with this. And this is the spacer that we use to buy back all those threads to make this unadjustable neck completely adjustable. Now this portion of the neck here, where the square part of the maple is received into the body, this was leveled fairly heavily to be able to get the lay of the neck along the trajectory of the string path, crown to crown to crown, from the first fret to the last. We have our self-adjusting radius gauge, spring-loaded with that low-density foam. So once the intonation was done, then we triple-checked this again to make sure the radius of the strings matched the radius of the fingerboard. The other thing that I should mention is the slot in the saddles for both the low E and the A string was pinching the string. You could see it on the tuner that you're getting kind of a wavering overtone or undertone or something that shouldn't have been there. Once I filed that slot out and opened it up for the proper diameter of the E and A string, all of that wavering in the tuner disappeared. I didn't have to do that for the D and the G. It was just the two bigger strings. The two volume pots were quite scratchy, so I did lubricate both of them. Here's another little tip. I slip that straw over top and give this a blast. And that is how I cleaned and lubricated those pods. Just when you think you're all done, well, the next thing was this pod here was completely burned out. I could barely turn it. That's the original pod. So I wired in a new pod. Now the bass is working 100% perfectly fine, as it should. For whatever reason, the previous guy decided to put Strat knobs on this jazz bass. I just happened to have some extra knobs in my junk box and I swapped them out. I didn't have the exact knob for the tone control, but it certainly looks better than the goofy Strat knobs. Anyway, so that's all done. Of course, adjusted the pickups. The thing plays buttery smooth and the intonation is perfect. So this is a quick kind of triad check. Octave lower. I always thought it was very clever the way the electronics works on the jazz bass. You can change the tone so drastically by backing off the neck pickup volume or the bridge pickup volume slightly. So this is everything wide open, tone in both volumes. If I back off the bridge pickup, then we get a thicker. And if I do the same with the neck pickup, I go to the bridge. So this is both wide open. Back off the bridge pickup. This is both wide open. This is the neck pickup backed off. Bring them both open again. And now I'll back off the bridge pickup.